In August of 2020, up-and-coming Twitter artist John Bob was exposed as being a groomer. While it was everywhere on the site at the time, no one has discussed the full story of John Bob. It's the story of an art community that didn't exist until he created it, and couldn't survive once he fell. A meteoric rise and fall all within a year, whose story has been memory-holed after months of deactivations and suspensions. And it's one I was a first-hand witness to, even being involved at one point. This is the story of John Bob, and how he single-handedly created and destroyed an art community. For years, John struggled to find success. At first, he stuck to art-centric sites like DeviantArt and Amino, before mainstream platforms like YouTube. But these efforts garnered very little attention. It wouldn't be until late 2019 that he finally found a place he could succeed, Twitter. What John excelled at was creating simple, good-looking animations within a small time frame. This made his work perfect for the site's algorithms, which he'd hone in on September with the creation of John Bob's Quest. It was an interactive choose-your-own-adventure-style series, in which he'd take commands from the viewer and then animate the results.
Which door should I go through? How about you decide?
In addition to being well-animated, it had an inoffensive, PG sense of humor that made him very marketable. As a result, the series spread very quickly throughout the art community, with several moderate to large figures promoting him. Having created his account in 2016, it sat at just under 1,500 followers. Within the next month alone, that number doubled and would only increase faster over time. Upon this sudden influx of support, John knew he had to capitalize on the momentum. He quickly began reaching out to many of the artists who had interacted with him, finally building the connections he'd long sought for. Within the next year alone, he would accumulate nearly 35,000 followers. With his rising popularity, there was already incentive to befriend John at this point. But simply being a rising star alone wouldn't make you capable of forming a new community. In the past, John would always create art affirming that he and his friends were friends, so it wasn't long before he brought that habit to Twitter. Keeping in line with his focus on community interactivity, he first did an open collab to the public, in which they could draw their characters hanging out with them. But the pivotal moment was his game created in celebration of Halloween, John Bob's Halloween Bash. Boasting over 20 characters, all of them were Twitter artists ranging from the likes of Chipple Dipple to Hannah Deigel's character Satina. In asking one of the artists featured in the game, I learned that they weren't asked prior to being included. It was something John had done as a surprise. In that sense, it wasn't really a friend group yet, as much as an elaborate piece of fan art. With a cast that cumulatively had tens of thousands of fans, even tweets just promoting the game got thousands of likes. But more importantly was the response from the artists themselves. By including them all in a context where they all appeared as associates, he effectively manifested the friend group into reality. As they all grew closer to him and began interacting with him, they by effect became closer to each other. For reference, from my days back in the animation community, people would often draw YouTubers hanging out with each other purely based on proximity. With a label as broad as the Twitter art community, this sense of unity didn't exist. At least, not until John Bob. As a result of his efforts, many of the artists he brought together became friends. They began interacting with each other and sharing an audience. These collaborations soon took priority over his Quest series, as he focused on strengthening his connections. His banner even came to reflect this. Of note in this incarnation are Chocovania and Wonder Waffle, who would become of the most prominent in his later works. While Rome wasn't built in a day, this new clique of Twitter artists seemingly established itself overnight. But alas, all empires must fall, and it wasn't long before the first cracks in their unity began to show. If there's one thing I've learned from using the platform, Twitter friendships are frail. Most of the people you'll meet will self-destruct before you ever learn their real name. With John including so many artists without permission, he associated people with each other that didn't necessarily want to be. And inevitably, this set the scene for the first fragments in the community. As a general trend, 2019 saw the resurgence of Minecraft in popularity. YouTuber Call Me Carson established SMP Live in March of that year, causing many to rediscover their love of the game. Minecraft was in fact a large part of what brought the art community together. While he was still producing John Bob's Quest, one path that received a lot of attention was his adventure into the Minecraft world. Similarly, the aforementioned Inkplasm grew exponentially after his interpretations of several Minecraft mobs went viral. Previously known for his Garfield and Oni Plays animations, Chip was also a featured artist in John Bob's Halloween Bash. In early October, Chip conceptualized the idea of SMP Earth, a streamer-centric multiplayer server set on a 1 to 2000 scale map of Earth. It eventually materialized into an actual event, one of which was witnessed by millions on YouTube and tripled Chip's audience. Its only relevance to this community, however, is in establishing how Chip caught the unwanted attention of Minecraft stans.
Chip, for the love of fucking God, either step off your platform or probably be prepared to be deplatformed.
At the time, several artists told him in private that while they supported him, they could no longer associate with him due to the constant cycle of hot takes and backlash. Even John Bob disassociated with him at one point, though returned for unknown reasons. With several of those initial artists weeded out, John now had a choice group of associates which he invited to his private Discord. It was reserved for those he trusted enough to vent his personal life to. As his audience grew, so did its membership, as he regularly searched for new additions. This was when the inner circle element of the community became apparent, as it was clear that a sizable number of people were networking through John. Meanwhile, John continued creating animations starring his friends. In May, he submitted an entry for the Newgrounds Pet Jam, winning third place. In April, he created Toon Smash, a cartoon of him fighting Chocovania in a Smash Bros-style fighting game. To reinforce how strongly John associated his friend group together, they were featured so prominently that many confused them as being his original characters. Notice anything about this banner? While the idea of John starting an artist harem began as a joke, many began to suspect its reality. In creating a community where he was the face, he was now in a position of power in which he could offer to introduce smaller artists to their inspirations. Keep in mind that at his peak, he was associated with artists like Shen Comics and Salty DK Dan. Additionally, John Bob began a podcast called the Twitcast, another avenue to incentivize smaller artists into befriending him. If he was using his platform to pick up girls, it certainly wasn't all one-sided. Many of these associates played along, with a now-deleted podcast episode even centering around Benny B's thighs. Not helping his case were leaked tweets from his private account, in which he yearned for romance from his followers. In January, he wrote, "I hope I don't get embarrassed for being too horny on Main. Sometimes I wonder if I have any fans who want to fuck me." The greatest casualty, however, was the release of John's private artwork. This began to unfold the mask that was his public persona. Firstly, the fact that it was in the same style as his animations was just off-putting, but it also seemed to give credence to speculation of his artist harem. Either they knew what he was drawing and played along, or he drew it without their consent, revealing ulterior motives. Until this point, I've refrained from talking about my own involvement in the community, but a large part of this chapter relates to what I witnessed myself rather than what I found from research. Tarid was a 20-year-old horror artist who became a front-page staple on Newgrounds. A former commentary artist, he was well known for his work on the Binding of Isaac series. We eventually became mutuals on Twitter, though we wouldn't talk regularly until I joined his server on August 12th, 2020. We had a similar sense of humor, and it was just fun to shoot the shit with him and his friends. We even did an art trade at one point. Tarid was one of the earliest members of John's clique, though was more critical of him than most. By either fate or total coincidence, I joined right before it all began to crumble, and consequently witnessed it with him. On August 18th, a loose associate of John Bob and popular artist in his own right named Get Good Nami was outed as being a pedophile. The alleger was a 15-year-old boy who'd been friends with him since he was 12. Nami is currently in his 30s. In December of 2016, they were invited to Nami's private Discord server. Nami would ask invasive questions about his personal life, eventually convincing the victim to send a picture of his face. Nami called him cute and began pestering for more photos. The request gradually became more suggestive. When the victim eventually refused, Nami blocked him and deleted all their messages. The accuser then relays stories from other victims, including one in which Nami convinced a 13-year-old boy to photograph himself in underwear. Nami's response came only one day later, but rather than address the allegations, he concluded he simply needed to separate the internet from reality. He never returned to Twitter after the subsequent backlash. While Nami was only loosely associated with John, his outing was used to berate him. Perhaps this was a bit unfair, given there was no evidence against John at the time, but it was the first outing in the community's immediate psyche. In the late hours of August 30th, John Bob posted a series of tweets outing himself as a groomer. He writes that someone he'd been friends with years ago had shared some DMs that he long forgotten. They were of a sexual nature. She was 15 at the time, and he was 18. But still. In these chat logs, he asked her to draw pornographic art of her character, later admitting he jerked off to an art piece she'd sent him. John, aren't you a minor, dude? Ugh. Anon, yes. John, how old are you again? Anon, 15 and a half. John, fuck, what would you say if I actually nutted to this? Haha, I'll draw a hentai of us if you RP with me sometimes. Other chat logs show him convincing her to draw not safe for work art before again informing her that he jerked off to an animation she made. These conversations took place in early 2019, before he found success on Twitter. He goes on to state that at the time, he thought it was okay due to the age difference. He then claims that he now understood it was wrong, begging for forgiveness as he was simply ignorant. He concludes that he'd not been pressured to do this, and was motivated solely by his own guilt. The latter was proven unequivocally false, as leaked messages show him venting about how she'd threatened to leak them. He even admitted in the first sentence that she'd reminded him, so it seems odd he'd even try lying about that. This call with Tarhead when these allegations were made public. After months of half-heartedly defending him, the dark irony of these baseless accusations turning out to be true were impossible to ignore. He'd lost my sympathy. Tarhead, on the other hand, was far more forgiving. Though he laughed alongside me, after I'd went to sleep, he wrote on Twitter, "I personally don't think John Bob is a monster, but a pervert and a touch-starved simp for sure, and that is what fucked his judgment. You need to keep these kinds of feelings in check because you might do something you regret and hurt people at the expense of your desires. Get help." By the time I woke up, Tarhead himself had been outed as a groomer. The accuser was angered by Tarhead's apologetics for John, and in the hours following the outing, wrote a document exposing Tarhead himself as a groomer. She released it on a separate Twitter account that afternoon. They'd met at the beginning of 2020 through a mutual friend server. After only a few days of talking, they had phone sex. At this point, Tar was unaware of her age. Filled with guilt, the next day, she called him in tears, admitting she was only 15. He didn't seem concerned, however, and continued sexting her. By March, he was still talking about how he wanted to have sex with her and complimenting her body. Tarhead was 21 years old. She writes, "The thing I am most ashamed of is the fact that he has seen my breasts. I showed him my breasts and he came to them. He also used to have a photo of me saved on his phone that he said he would keep for later." Eventually, Tar began to realize the gravity of his actions, attempting to distance himself from her. Instead of doing this in a rational way, he tried to make her leave by aggressively insulting her. This got to the point where she'd often cry herself to sleep over it. She tried cutting him off in April of 2020, sending him the message, "I can't take it anymore. Tarhead, you are an N-word." But they continued talking casually for months. As she confided in the relationship to her friends, they helped her realize that she was being groomed. Eventually, she was able to bring herself to confront him on August 12th, 2020. "Chucky, I feel like I may have been groomed a little bit by you. I know some of it is my fault, but I'm just 15. When I met you, I was going through being depressed and I felt a bit lonely. I wanted validation from someone. I feel sick. I know this is going to haunt me for the rest of my life." Tar, what the hell did I take from you? I don't want to talk to you. It will just make it worse for everyone." Chucky, "I just want something. Like, I feel empty. I just want a genuine thing, I guess." Tarhead, "You don't deserve anything. I fucking hate you. I wish I never fucking met you. You ruined so much of my fucking life. I just want to get the fuck away from you. Forget I ever met your dumbass. I don't owe you fucking shit. I didn't know any better from the beginning. Took me a while to realize and I wanted a fucking way out. I wanted to get out from you because all you were was a constant reminder." This message, in which he rants for the victim to leave him alone, was sent the same day I joined his server for the first time. Suddenly, all the vague allusions he made to ex-friends as well as the fear of cancellation made sense. After that day, I never spoke to Tarhead again. Naturally, given that John had attempted to get in front of the allegations, he wasn't eager to lose his platform. Once his victims started speaking out themselves, he deactivated, before reactivating upon realizing it was a coward's move. He then retweeted posts calling himself a pedophile before being bullied into deactivation again. All of the bridges he'd built in the past year were burnt to ash, as one by one they left his private server and disavowed him publicly. Chocovania released a statement that surmised their perspective rather well. Most of those involved were just artists excited to share with people they admired. They were largely unaware of his wrongdoing. John Bob went from a beloved figure in the community to being universally hated overnight. The Tarhead callout was mysteriously deleted less than 24 hours after it was posted, though it didn't stop the evidence from circulating. As it turns out, he and the victim spoke that night, and she felt so badly about his mental state that she tried to prevent it from spreading further. The next day, Tarhead released a public apology with several screenshots showing that he recognized it was wrong before being called out. This did little to quell the fact that the relationship had continued for half a year. He also included a message from her showing her pining for him and to stop saying their ages. While the victim says they're out of context, regardless, she was a minor. He should have known better. While Tarhead intended to simply release the statement and leave the account public while seeking therapy, his account has since been deactivated. As mentioned before, Tarhead was originally a commentary artist, and in my time speaking to him, I learned he was a massive Leafy fan. Well, Tarhead's account deletion came only minutes after Leafy himself responded to the apology, stating, "I don't know why this is on my Twitter, but I'm not reading that shit." Since his cancellation, John has attempted to return on multiple occasions. He's reached out to several mutuals asking if they were okay with him before blocking them if they weren't. It's no secret that John was an introvert in real life. His only way out was online success. But as he grew more dependent on social media, needing that rush of dopamine and instant gratification to feel content, he became dysfunctional. He became so sick of using the John Bob character as a mask that he began aggressively rejecting it. But he had built so much of his life around that persona, from his relationships to his income to his identity, that it was impossible for him to escape it by himself. So once it was all torn away from him, with his public image tainted forever, all that was left was a man who was deeply unhappy with his life in spite of his talent. John was an extremely competent animator, so much so that I'm confident in saying that had he continued, he could have built a living off of it. But what held him back was his personal failings, which ultimately led to his downfall. But what makes John so unique is that his personal failings didn't just destroy him, but an entire online community. His public persona became the backbone of this massively successful friend group. Most of these artists are still around today, but seldom will you ever see them interact with each other. It's not out of personal vendetta or beef, they just don't have a lot in common. With how much variation there is amongst the different artists of Twitter, the person John presented himself as was perfect for uniting them. His lovable, wholesome personality made him the commonality, but as the glue began to weaken, so did the structure, as the community returned to nothing more than the scattered fragments it was before. We try our best to give people the benefit of the doubt. If they've made mistakes, we want to give them a chance to change who they are. But consistently, we find this trust abused. People looked up to these artists. They trusted them and considered them friends. And had it not been for John Bob, most of them wouldn't have ever met each other. But underlying it all is this inescapable reality that these abusers thrived in this environment. Making this video gave me a sense of closure I never got when it all first happened. The moral of the story here? I don't fucking know, dude.